Yeah, sure. Yeah, thank you so much for inviting me and for speaking with me. My name is Vincent Bevins. I'm a journalist from the United States. Most recently, I wrote a book called The Jakarta Method, which I started while I was covering Southeast Asia for the Washington Post. Before that, I was here in Brazil working as a correspondent for 6 years. And before that, I was in London working at the Financial Times. So I've been working with international journalism in sort of mainstream corporate press in the English language for a little over a decade now. Yeah, very briefly, this is a book about anti-communist mass murder. It is about the intentional extermination of left-wing civilians or people accused of being left-wing in the context of the Cold War. In addition to telling that story, to sort of just explaining what happened, especially in 1965 when the U.S.-backed Indonesian military killed approximately 1 million innocent people. In addition to just sort of laying that out, the book tries to drive home that this method, this tactic, the intentional mass murder of leftists was an incredibly important part of the Cold War and really shaped the world that the Cold War gave us, which is the one we're in now. Yeah, absolutely. As I said, so all of my background has been in mainstream, middle of the road English language journalism. And when I got to Jakarta in 2017, after leaving Sao Paulo, which is where I am now, my job was just to cover Southeast Asia, to explain what was happening to an audience in the United States primarily, but also globally. And it came to the conclusion very quickly, it became quite obvious after arriving there that no matter what I was doing about contemporary Indonesian politics, society, life, this story of the 1965 mass murder of the Indonesian Communist Party and its associates was really lurking below the surface of everything that I looked at. So to tell any kind of story responsibly about the present of Indonesia and the present of Southeast Asia, I needed to look into this massacre, which is still denied by its perpetrators. And really remained untold, especially in the Indonesian context. But I also found that people outside of Indonesia knew very little about it as well. And as I dug deeper and deeper into this story, it became my main focus. Eventually, I put aside everything else that I was doing. And part of the reason that I came to the conclusion that this would be something that I could do, that I had something maybe to add to this, to the literature, was I realized that there were strong connections between the Indonesian massacre and Latin America, which is where I had spent a big part of my career and where I knew a lot of people. So it was really it was a story that was incredibly important to what I was doing as a journalist. And I realized that it connected to other things that I had done as a journalist. And so I put aside my regular correspondent work and just got to working on this book full time, because I thought it was so important and so difficult a subject that I had to really throw myself into it entirely. Yeah, exactly. So as I claim in the book that the mass murder of the Indonesian Communist Party in 1965, which was the largest socialist party outside of the Soviet Union and China, the largest communist party in the world, and I think maybe the largest democratic socialist party in history, that this massacre was a real turning point in the Cold War, perhaps the most important turning point in the Cold War. But what we know for sure is that it was considered a huge victory by the Western powers, especially the United States and other North Atlantic powers like Britain. And it was considered such a success for the anti-communist side of the Cold War, for right-wing movements around the world, for the United States and its allies, for potential allies of the United States, that it became sort of a reference point. It became something that could be copied, that could be seen as a source of inspiration, or simply as a way to threaten your enemies. So in the early 70s in both Brazil and Chile, you see the use of Jakarta being employed by right-wing groups, groups in Chile that were sort of trying to terrorize the democratically elected Allende government and supporters, and being used behind the scenes by the Brazilian military dictatorship. And the use of this word Jakarta in both cases was employed to signify the intentional mass murder of leftists. So this graffiti that you refer to in Chile, which appeared up on the walls in 1972 of Santiago, or these postcards that arrived in the homes of communists or of employees of the democratically elected Allende government, this was meant to say, we're going to do to you what the Indonesians did to their communists. We're going to kill you. Jakarta is coming, you're going to die. And very tragically, in 1973, Jakarta did come with the successful U.S.-backed coup in Chile in the installation of the junta and later the Pinochet dictatorship. You did see the mass murder of leftists in Chile and people who had received this warning in 1972. So this was a horrible and terribly important massacre in Indonesia in 1965 that then ended up serving sort of as a model, if not, if only, or at least just a reference point for other violent anti-communist movements in the rest of the Cold War that were looking for ways to help to consolidate U.S.-backed authoritarian capitalist regimes. And by the end of the 1970s, in all of South America, you have murderous U.S.-backed authoritarian capitalist regimes. And then this group helps to spread the use of the tactic into Central America in the 1980s. And by the end of the book, by the end of the Cold War, I find that there was at least 22 cases around the world where the intentional mass murder of leftists was carried out in the successful attempts to construct authoritarian capitalist regimes as part of the so-called free world, the group of countries allied with the United States in the North Atlantic against the Soviet Union. So if you talk about the Jakarta method in the broadest sense, and I use the Jakarta method to signify every time that the intentional mass murder of leftists occurred in the Cold War, 1965 in Indonesia was not actually the first case. The first case was probably Guatemala in 1954, one of the first successful coups carried out by the Young Central Intelligence Agency in the United States, the CIA having just been founded after the end of World War II, with the goal of, well, officially the goal of providing information to the president, but very often the goal of suppressing communism or anything that looked anything like it around the world. And in Guatemala, you did not have communism. You had a mildly liberal reformer in Jacobo Arbenz. And after the coup, which removed him from power, the United States, according to testimony at the time, pressed the new military regime to carry out the mass murder of leftists. So by 1965, and this is an important thing that I try to point to in the book, it was not just the left in the Cold War that had international operations that learned from each other, that traded sort of tips and tricks and advice. The right over the international right, the violent anti-communist forces, which I believed were ultimately victorious in the Cold War, from 1954 to 1965, they sort of were developing their tactics. They were sort of getting better at figuring out what kind of things worked, establishing ideological hegemony in military forces with the use of funding and training in the United States was an important tactic that was developed over this period. Until by 1965, you had an incredibly successful transfer of power from a anti-colonial, left-leaning country, Indonesia, to a firmly anti-communist country led by General Suharto. And Indonesia, just to drive home how important this was, in the early 60s, Indonesia was considered far more important to the U.S. foreign policy establishment than Vietnam was. So you get the solidification of what ultimately becomes Jakarta by 1965, but it wasn't the first time this was used. And then you get the importation into South America in the early 70s, right? Especially with the use of the explicit use of the term Jakarta. So you have Chile in 1972, which becomes the actual violent Pinochet regime in 1973. You have the Brazilian military dictatorship, which took took power around the same time as the Suharto dictatorship in Indonesia, which had been fomenting a right-wing movements in Chile up until 1973. And then after Jakarta comes, as it were, to Chile, Brazil and Chile and a bunch of other authoritarian capitalist regimes in South America get together to form something called Operation Condor with the assistance of the United States. And Operation Condor is an international mass murder network, which consists of the right-wing authoritarian capitalist regimes in South America coming together to find ways to kill their enemies wherever they may be. So this informal alliance of military dictatorships in South America was not content to just kill all the leftists in their own countries, or kill all the people in their own countries that they believed to be a threat, or kill all the people in their countries that weren't a threat at all, but they wanted to get rid of for some reason. Pinochet, of course, going after members of the military that had refused to support the coup and just wanted to write their memoirs. They came together to form an alliance that would allow them to kill them anywhere. And so they started to carry out mass murders, not only in their countries, but across borders and around the world, ultimately killing people in the United States, targeting people in Europe. And Operation Condor was incredibly important in solidifying the set of political and economic arrangements, which I believe are still in place today in South America. So by the end of the 70s, most of South America has employed the Jakarta Method, what I call the Jakarta Method. And then by the 1980s, you get the eruption of what the United States and its allies consider to be problems in Central America. And Operation Condor advisors go to Central America and start to advise Central American dictatorships on the use of counterinsurgency methods, mass terror, mass murder. And then again, you get the discussion of the you know, what is called Plan Jakarta in this context, which takes place between Argentine anti-communist death squads, the leader of a Guatemalan death squad, and the participation apparently of an American official in Spain in the 1980s. So really by the end of the Cold War, a huge amount of Latin America has gone through this horrible process. And I believe that the set of political and economic arrangements which are still in place in Latin America are largely shaped in this era. Well, first I should make clear that I didn't discover much myself. Largely what I did in the case of Indonesia especially was build on the heroic work of scholars and activists that has been done over decades and decades in Indonesia, and just kind of take that, summarize it, add a little bit of human element to the story by interviewing survivors, and then globalizing that story. So I want to make clear that this story has been well known by people who've been cared enough to look for a very long time. And what I actually added to the literature was very small relative to the work that's been done over decades and decades in Latin America and in Indonesia. But officially, in Indonesia, it's illegal to even say what actually happened. Officially, anything that can be construed as sympathy or support for anything Marxist-Leninist is illegal in Indonesia, get you thrown in jail. They do throw people in jail for this. I have not been back to Indonesia since the book came out, and it is possible that I will not be allowed in the country or that I could face some kind of consequences if I do. The book is now being translated into a number of languages, Indonesian included. And one thing we have to decide when it comes out in Indonesia is, should I go there and should we do a book launch, or is this going to invite possibly violence? Is this going to be a very difficult thing to do given the situation in Indonesia. Now, in the English-speaking world, the response has been really surprisingly positive. I kind of expected more people to come at this, not on the merits, just sort of, you know, as a knee-jerk reaction to say, well, it can't be true that the United States did something that bad. How dare you? But at least until now, I haven't got that. The response has been really positive, even center-right or right-wing outlets in the United States, although they're not quite as enthusiastic about it as often left-wing reviewers are. were very complimentary, said this is an important story that needed to be told. And I think that's because it's very hard. I mean, once you get to just look at the facts of what happened to these people in Indonesia and who it was that were really victimized, and when you put those people up front and center, it becomes very hard to come to any other conclusion than what happened to them was horrible and needs to be rejected, condemned, and discussed. So I've been very lucky personally. I've been overwhelmed with the response to the book. And as I said, it's being translated everywhere. In Indonesia, who knows what's going to happen? I'm the people that are translating it now, it's a really brave and small and great publisher that took on this project. And I hope everything goes well when it finally does come out there. Well, so in one sense, there's a big divergence in between Latin America and Indonesia as to whether or not the chapters are closed, in the sense that at the end of the 20th century, many countries in South America went through an official process of truth and reconciliation where they admitted to what happened, apologized to the victims, and often the victims entered the mainstream of political politics or even the presidency in a way which would never happen in Indonesia. There has never been anything like a truth and reconciliation commission. But yeah, what I would say in the last 5 years is that that chapter which had appeared to be closed is reopened, especially here in Brazil. In 2013-15, if you would have asked me if a supporter of Brazil's military dictatorship, of someone who had called very loudly for the mass murder of leftists in his own country, could return to power in South America's largest country, I would have found that very unlikely. And that's what we have now. I mean, if I walk out this door right now, things are very bad out there. And it's because of the return of somebody that very much represents the full resuscitation, the full resurrection of the ideology that powered Brazil's military dictatorship. Now, the question of US intervention in Latin America is very interesting, because I think we have to make two points at the same time, that whose consequences can be subtle, but I think it's important. One, the United States never changed its overall posture vis-a-vis Latin America. There has never been anything like the collapse of the CIA or an entirely new set of driving principles behind U.S. foreign policy. The U.S. foreign policy is still driven by the same set of power relations and ideological components that it was in the 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s. You do not have some kind of a break at the end of the Cold War where the United States stops looking out for its geopolitical interests. It didn't stop prioritizing the possibility of American and international capital being able to enter foreign markets. It did not stop doing secret or illegal things. It did not stop believing that it had a right to affect the future of countries where it deemed that it had an interest. At the same time, we also have to realize that we live in a world in which the coups and the interventions of the Cold War were actually successful, right? So we don't tend to see, in my opinion, and views on the left here are divided in Brazil. But I don't think that what you tend to see, what you would expect to tend to see, is an exact repeat of the kind of things that you saw in 1954 in Guatemala or in Chile in 1973. And that's because, not because the United States is better or cares more about human rights, it's because hegemony is much more firmly established than it was back then. You don't have the outright contestation that is visible in the way that you had it in Guatemala in 1954. You have a much broader set of tools with which the United States can affect outcomes in Latin America. And of course, you saw coups. I mean, you saw the U.S.-backed coup in Venezuela in 2002. Very clear attempts to carry out more coups in Venezuela over the years, most outrageously and obviously under Trump, outrageously in the sense that the plans were just ridiculous and fell apart in a spectacular way. But while that happens, you also have a much wider set of tools that can be put to use, because the Cold War happened and the United States won. So that's a long way of saying that some chapters were closed, but then they were reopened. And in Indonesia, none of this story was ever closed in the first place.